Demography, just like any other field, has its own jargon or terms. While we don't need to become expert at sounding like a demographer, a number of terms used in the science of demography are also commonly used in the field of urban planning. So let's go over a few of them. First, and likely already familiar, is the term fertility. In demography, it refers to the number of live births, often expressed as the number of actual live births to women in a particular age cohort. Sometimes this is also referred to as the fertility rate. And if you've listened to the news over the past several years, you may have noted that in many developed countries, fertility rates have been dropping. This is something watched closely by demographers. Fertility rates can vary significantly geographically, culturally, and over time.
Japan's leaders are working on a raft of new measures to encourage citizens to get married and have children in a bid to boost the country's flagging birth rate. With fewer babies being born and a rapidly aging population, Japan is facing an unprecedented demographic crisis with vast social, economic, and political repercussions. So, what's at the heart of the problem? And what's being done to fix it? Adrian Brown has been to the shrinking town of Nanmoku to find out.
It's 7 a.m. in the mountain village of Nanmoku, announced with typical Japanese eccentricity by the town alarm clock. Seven-year-old Yusuke Aiwa and his brother and sister are off to school. Nanmoku Elementary School dwarfs the houses around it. There used to be over 1,200 students here. Now there are only 37. Every year, fewer babies are being born and more young people are leaving. Hundreds of homes and businesses are boarded up or abandoned. Left behind are the elderly. More than half of the population is over the age of
65.
Women in the labor force typically have lower fertility rates than women not in the labor force. Recall that fertility is not the ability to have children, but the actual number of births.
Today, more than half of Japanese women are still single by the time they're 30. Karu Arai is a professional harpist. She epitomizes the country's new breed of successful and financially independent women who are putting career first and postponing marriage and motherhood.
Did you always think that marriage and children was a certainty?
Yes, I've always thought that I would be a mom, and I would have a family just like my parents.
Yeah. And now?
And I don't know, all of a sudden I'm 32. And just hasn't happened yet.
Statistically, the majority of childbirth-giving females are 20 to 29 years of age. Over time, this number has skewed older, particularly as more women are entering the labor force. Fertility rates also tend to have an inverse relationship with wealth or a country's GDP. As a country's economy develops, couples tend to wait longer to have children and also have fewer children altogether. Some other important terms include median age, which is simply defined as the age at which half of the population is older and half is younger. If a population is growing as a result of fertility, we call it a natural increase, which is where there's an excessive number of births over deaths for the year. Something that, for almost all countries, has increased with more development and wealth over time is life expectancy, which is fairly self-explanatory. It denotes the average number of years to be lived by a group of people born in the same year. Circling back now on a familiar term, the total fertility rate is the average number of births per woman. Similarly, replacement level fertility is used to describe the fertility level in the long term to ensure that population replaces itself and is a 2-to-1 ratio of children per woman. The balance of sex in a population is traditionally important to replacement level fertility. We call this the sex ratio, and it's a formula that is the total males or females divided by population multiplied by 100. To get a better handle on the potential need for social infrastructure over time, demographers use the dependency ratio, which is a measure of the percent of the population that will need some type of assistance. The formula for the dependency ratio is children plus elderly divided by total population times 100. In many developed countries, the latter half of the numerator is growing substantially over the former and many other age cohorts. That means that the number of elderly are outpacing the number of children. And in general, this means the population is aging.
Tomio invites me to meet his family.
What's the name? Australia.
Australia. Yes.
Australia.
Yes.
He only married 4 years ago and says he and his wife are too old to have children of their own. The couple care for Tomio's elderly parents. In bustling Tokyo, there's little sense of the impending crisis. But some experts warn that within a millennium, the Japanese people themselves could be extinct.
Related to all of this is the number of live births per 1,000 population. This is referred to as the crude birth rate and is the ratio of births to population times 1,000, where P is the total mid-year population. A few more terms worth noting that are not specific to demography but are frequently used in the science are three related terms: projection, forecast, or estimate. The terms are often misused and frequently interchanged or used as synonyms for each other, but in fact, each has its own distinct meaning, and that distinction is important. First, the term projection. Projections are conditional statements about the future. They refer mostly to the exercise of extrapolation of past trends into the future, and they do not take into account changes in the policy parameters. For example, take a region that has experienced a growth rate of, say, 3% a year over the past decade and currently has a population of 10,000 people. Then you could construct a simple projection that at the end of the next decade, the population would be 13,439. Here we use a compounding growth rate function, and we'll see how this works in just a moment. What this projection doesn't account for is the possibility of some change in policy, such as establishment of an urban services boundary, or a downturn in the economy, or some macroscopic change in fertility due to larger economic or political forces. To capture larger potential changes, or in some cases, more nuanced changes in the underlying structure of the population, demographers will develop a population forecast. In the case of figuring out how our policy might impact future population, if the policy parameters are incorporated into the projections, that is, the likely effects of policy changes are to be judged and projections are made accordingly, they become a forecast. In some cases, this is where scenario planning comes in. In developing a forecast, we might consider how not building out a highway to a rural part of the city will impact that area's growth. Maybe our previous hypothetical city was growing at 3% because it had a robust program of development in the suburbs, supported by large highway investments. If we now build a projection where the highway investments are taken away, let's say halfway into the next decade, we may assume that population growth will slow to 2% as suburban growth is reduced due to a lack of access. Our projection that now includes implications is a forecast, and we arrive at a future population of 12,799. If we consider other policy angles, like the impact of increasing our highway building or developing public transit, or building our sewer and water services to more rural areas, then we are effectively scenario planning. Finally, while population projections refer to future dates, a population estimate refers to current or past dates. If, for example, you have a population for 2010 and for 2020, but you want a population figure for 2015, a simple calculation of what population would be in that year would be an estimate. For our projection example, if the 10,000 population figure was from 2010 and the 2,000 population was 7,600, you could estimate that in 2005, population was roughly 8,800. In general, population projections are treated as predictions and are never to be treated as a final population count. Though more technically a set of characteristics than terms, it is also important to be familiar with size, composition, and spatial distribution. Size is the basic yardstick for estimating space needs for various categories of land use, retail, office, manufacturing, housing, etc., as well as needs for infrastructure and community facilities like parks and schools. We've already talked about composition, but it bears repeating. Composition refers to the sizes of specific age groups, household types, and socioeconomic levels of the population. Spatial distribution is the arrangement of something, in this case, probably people or populations, across some area, whether a neighborhood or a town or a country or the entire planet. This is important to planning because it's used to determine the locations of various land uses and community facilities along with the spatial distribution of that population.
By the middle of the century, almost half of Japan's population will be over the age of 65, something that the town of Nomuku is already familiar with. Cafe owner Hiroko Imai, closing up after another quiet day, is worried about what the future will bring.
ただまだそれは簡単には解決はできない。